Chapter 12. Treason on Thames-side. I can tell you, the lowest window looked mighty high from the boat in which I sat, and I decided rather to try the upper windows, since there was less risk of anyone being in the bedrooms at this time of the evening. Luckily, heights don't trouble me. I've scrambled about on too many crags at home when below me there was sickening space followed by hard rock instead of water to break my fall. It had been a quarter to eight when I took the boat out. Now, as I groped in the gloom for something to tie it to, the time must have been only a few minutes short of the hour. The water slapped against the wall. As I stood up, the boat creaked and echoed woodenly. Far upriver, a party of diners out sang lustily as their boat zigzagged towards Westminster. Their torches streamed redly in the green twilight. Anyone who happened to be scanning the Thames at that moment was far more likely to be watching the revellers than noticing the shadowy figure under the wall. There was nothing to which I could tie my boat, so it was lucky I had brought all the daggers I could lay hands on. I drove one into a wooden pillar which stood out from the stone foundation wall. It didn't go in very far. The wood was tough. I pulled it out and tried again, using more force. This time it seemed firmly embedded. I knotted the painter of the boat round its crossed handle and prepared to climb. The first 10 feet were the worst. There were no holds, and I had to use daggers thrust into the timber with all my force. It isn't easy to drive a dagger into hard timber, especially when you're standing on another dagger and precariously holding on by your left hand to a third. Each time I put my weight on a fresh dagger, my heart went into my mouth, and I nerved myself for the splash below. Each time I lifted my foot from the lowest dagger, I felt the wildest exultation of relief. Soon it got easier. There were beams projecting 3 or 4 inches from the smooth plaster and offering handy ledges for fingertips and toes. Above my head, but a little to the left, there was an open window. I decided to peep through very cautiously and, if the room was empty, to take a chance and swing my leg over the sill. The clocks would be striking the hour at any moment now, and that meant that Kit would put her share of the plan into execution. Once she started, there wouldn't be any time to waste. I was out of luck. The room wasn't empty. I could hear men's voices as I climbed higher. After all, I should have to use the top floor windows.
"Well, I don't intend to lose my head on Tower Hill,"
came the voice of the yellow gentleman, so suddenly and so crystal clear that I almost let go my hold.
"Oh, I know others have said that before me, and they've gone to the scaffold nonetheless. But it's different this time."
"My dear fellow," interposed a mild, mocking voice, "it always is different."
I shifted my position slightly and listened intently. Anxious as I was to stop playing the fly on the wall, I thought this conversation too interesting to miss. Luckily, I got a place where I could relax a little and remain, if need be, for several minutes without moving.
"I wish I could tell you more of the details," said the yellow gentleman irritably. "Then you wouldn't croak like an old frog. Anyhow, you know Morton."
"Morton?"
The unseen friend sounded as surprised as I was.
"You mean Philip Morton? Is he in this?"
"Up to his ears."
There was silence for a moment. Then the other voice said in a new tone,
"If Morton's in it, it is different. There's something unearthly about that young man. I remember when he first came to Whitehall, she took one look at him and said to Essex, 'The devil's come to court.' And she gave him about as cordial a welcome."
"I know," the yellow gentleman agreed. "He's never forgiven her."
All the clocks in the city began to strike. I flattened myself against the house, ready for action. The two voices went on in tranquil discussion, but I could gather no more than I had already guessed, that something like high treason was being plotted in that room, and that Sir Philip Morton, that bad penny of my life, seemed to be mixed up in it. Bang! Bang! Far away at the other side of the house, Kit was hammering madly on the street door. From where I was, I could hear it only dimly.
"What the deuce is that?"
said the yellow gentleman.
"Someone knocking?"
answered the other, like a fool. "But who?" I could guess they were feeling rather nervous. When you have a guilty secret, a sudden knocking on doors can be very upsetting. "I see," said the yellow gentleman, and I heard his chair grate back and the door of the room open. He called downstairs. I could hear nothing distinctly, and then he must have turned to address his companion. "Some girl, they say, attacked by a cut purse in the lane outside, came screaming and hammering on our gate. Let's go down, shall we?"
"By all means. Is it all right to leave these?"
"Oh, goodness, yes. There's nothing here that would hang a dog."
"Then let's go down and comfort the distressed damsel."
The door closed behind them, and in a couple of seconds my leg was over the windowsill. It was a small room. My eyes took in a tall cupboard, a couple of chairs, stools, a chest, a table bearing wine, candles, unlit, and a heap of books and papers. I could have whooped when I saw my play script, half hidden by what looked in the gloom like letters and household accounts. Perhaps I should have acted differently, bundled together as much of that litter as I could stuff into my doublet, or at any rate carried some to the window and tried to read it. True, the yellow gentleman had assured his friend that there was nothing incriminating, but I fancy I might have learnt some names, at least, which would have proved helpful afterwards, and saved me from some of the misfortunes which befell me. But there, I wasn't an experienced government agent then, and it wasn't second nature to me to do these things. I was a boy with his heart in his mouth, scared that at any moment the yellow gentleman might come back, perhaps to fetch the wine from the table to revive the distressed damsel. I'd got what I'd come for, and I wasn't stopping. I went through the window with a heavy wad of paper bulging my doublet and let myself down with infinite care. Going down was at least as bad as going up. I had to dangle my feet in the gathering darkness, swinging this way and that till I felt the foothold. When I got to my stairway of daggers, I had to pull them out after me, one by one, as I went down. It took a strong tug to bring them out of the timber, and I had to be careful lest the force I exerted should topple me from my precarious hold. As I drew them forth, I stuck them in my belt till I looked like a pirate, or should have done, had it been light enough to look like anything. The most awkward part was getting back into the boat, which had swung round on its painter and, as usual with boats when you leave them, wasn't at all where I had left it, or where I wanted. Still, I didn't worry by that time. I was safe enough now, even if I got a wetting. Actually, I avoided even that, and managed to step dry-shod into the boat after all. As I did so, one of the daggers slipped from my belt and plopped into the water with a mighty splash. That was a pity, I thought, and would cost me the price of a new one, but it was better than leaving the telltale weapon in the wall. "Only a water rat, I expect," came the yellow gentleman's voice, and to my dismay I saw his head far above me, dark against the glow of candlelight, peering down from the window. "No, there's a boat down there." I still hadn't untied the boat, and I knew that, what with unshipping the oars and everything, it would take me a minute or two to get outside pistol range. Better to disarm suspicion. I knew that the boat showed only dimly from the window above, and that I myself was visible only as a vague shape. That shape might just as well be two people huddled close as one. "Darling," I said in my huskiest, deepest voice.
"Dearest,"
I answered with a little feminine giggle, and then in a tone of alarm,
"Oh, Robbie, someone's looking."
"Be off with you," the yellow gentleman shouted. "You can't tie up there. Do your billing and cooing somewhere else, not under our windows." His voice faded as he turned back into the room. "Only a pair of lovesick idiots." I hurriedly got out the oars and sculled away. By the time I had restored the boat to its owner and gone to our agreed meeting place at Temple Bar, Kit was waiting for me, still in her girl's clothes. "Got it," I said triumphantly, and then, "What are you giggling about?" Kit was positively bubbling, like a kettle just ready to boil over.
"I fooled them so beautifully," she managed to get out. They sent a servant with me to see me safely inside the gates. They were so considerate. It was really a shame. They gave me wine to revive me.
I suppose that's why you're giggling like a child of 8, I said, taking her arm. She needed it. It was late when we got home to our lodgings. I lit a candle hurriedly while Kit looked round for some food. I wanted to assure myself that the play script was intact. Yes, it was complete. There was only one thing which puzzled me. In the middle of the play, in a long speech by the chorus, there was one sentence underlined. The nimble gunner with linstock now the devilish cannon touches, and down goes all before them. I knew that I hadn't marked those lines. The only man who would be likely to underline them would be the man in charge of the stage effects, and he, of course, had his own copy. It was a trivial, meaningless mystery, but it bothered me. I drew Kit's attention to it, but she could explain it no better than I.
"And what's this?"
she asked, turning the bundle of script and pointing to a few scribbled lines on the back. "Have you been composing poetry in your spare time? Plenty of crossing out, anyhow." I stared at the black, unfamiliar writing. Allowing for the numerous corrections, the verses ran, "Since words and wit are weak in friendship's need, even to say a tithe of that I would. Now bend a penetrating eye and read, divining how I'd greet thee if I could. No golden voice have I to sing thy praise. Eloquence is not mine, I lack the tongue, worthy to celebrate these happy days, singing their glory as it should be sung." It was a sonnet, and a pretty poor one, I thought. The second half went, "But 'tis the meaning matters, not the form. E whiz, the thought behind is more than face. Proserpina herself is not more warm, even when dusky Pluto's fond embrace, in falter than these wishes that I send, love-charged to hail the birthday of my friend." Underneath was scribbled 26 copies, and a tick, as though the copies had been duly made. "Silly stuff," I said. "I'd be ashamed to write it. It doesn't mean anything."
"On the contrary," retorted Kit, "I think it means a great deal. The question is, what exactly? More treason, if I know anything."